Back in 1927, a Swiss pediatrician, Guido Fanconi, was visited by distraught parents of three siblings. All three siblings appeared to be suffering from pernicious anemia and had physical abnormalities. Unfortunately, there wasn't much that Dr. Fanconi could do for the siblings back in 1927, and they passed away not long after their visit to his practice. Determined to understand as much as he could about what ailed the three siblings, Dr. Fanconi personally conducted an autopsy on the siblings and wrote a 23-page paper describing the symptoms of the patients. Dr. Fanconi's commitment to understanding the disorder that had plagued the siblings continued for 40 years, culminating in the disorder Fanconi Anemia being named after him. Dr. Fanconi was not alone in his work. Multiple talented researchers joined him. And by the 1960s, the disorder was recognized or characterized as having high levels of chromosome breakage that was spontaneous. The exaggerated chromosomal breakage could also be induced by exposure to agents that cause crosslinking of DNA bases, agents such as mitomycin C. This feature is subsequently used in diagnosis of FA patients. Ling and David Frohmeyer received devastating news in 1983. They learned that their two daughters, Katie and Kirsten, have FA. At this point in time, it is known that FA is a rare genetic disorder that causes bone marrow to fail in producing blood cells and also leads to early onset cancer. Frightened and feeling lonely, they decided that rather than become victims of the disease, they would fight. Their fight took the form of trying to discover as much about the disease as possible by supporting research into FA. Their dedicated commitment to trying to understand the molecular basis of Fanconi anemia starts to pay dividends with the first gene found to be associated with the disorder, FANCC, being identified in 1992. So what is Fanconi anemia? To get into that, we should know that DNA can and does get damaged on a daily basis. DNA can be damaged in various ways. The phosphate groups, or the ribose sugar, or the nitrogenous base, so the adenines, cytosines, thymine, and guanine, can encounter damage. The whole nucleotide can also encounter damage. The source of damage can be external. For example, ultraviolet light from the sun can affect nitrogenous bases in DNA by compressing adjacent cytosines and adjacent thymines to form what are known as cyclobutane dimers. The source of damage could also be internal. For example, did you know that hydrolytic reactions in the cell can result in cytosines being converted to uracil over time? Uracil pairs with adenine, while cytosine would have been pairing with guanine. So the cell has a mechanism for removing conversions of cytosines to uracil. DNA damage is initially sensed by proteins that phosphorylate other proteins to modify them for a particular activity, so they're called kinases. These initial DNA damage sensing proteins are Ataxia, Telangiectasia mutated, or ATM for short, and Ataxia, Telangiectasia and RAD3 related protein, or ATR. Ataxia, Telangiectasia mutated, and ATM and RAD3 related kinases, in turn, phosphorylate hundreds of other proteins that are needed for appropriate DNA damage sensing and repair. The Fanconi anemia pathway comprises 22 proteins that contribute to repairing DNA when it is damaged. It also assists during DNA replication and in other cellular processes. During DNA replication, the DNA in a cell is copied, what we call replicated, in what is known as a semi-conservative manner. This simply means that one strand of the double helix serves as the template for synthesis of the new strand. Well, in order to achieve this, a replication fork is formed while the existing DNA is being copied to build the new or nascent strand. Nucleotides are incorporated as the replication fork moves along, but addition of nucleotides can be impeded by obstacles such as, one, if there are damaged bases, or if there are DNA protein complexes, or if there are DNA-RNA hybrids, which are called R-loops, and certain structures can also halt replication fork movement. DNA structures such as G-quadruplexes and fragile sites can impede the movement of the replication fork. But the main barrier that the FA pathway deals with is the removal of cross-linking that sometimes occur within the strands of DNA, called interstrand cross-links. Interstrand cross-links can occur through internal, that is, endogenous sources, or external, that is, exogenous sources. The endogenous sources of interstrand cross-link include aldehydes and nitrous acid that are produced in the body as a result of metabolism. The exogenous sources of interstrand cross-links could be things like solarin and cisplatin that are used in cancer chemotherapy. If an interstrand cross-link occurs in DNA, then the FA pathway is activated during S phase in the cell cycle. So proteins called UHRF1 and FANCM MHF1 MHF2 complex sense interstrand cross-links during the S phase in the cell cycle. UHRF1 protein recruits FANCA, a protein called FANCA, and FANCG2. The FANCM MHF1 MHF2 complex recruit what is known as the Fanconi Anemia core complex. The FA core complex that is recruited by the FANCM MHF1 MHF2 complex is an E3 ligase. And as you know, ligases add, joins two things together. So the E3 ligase ubiquitinate FANCA and FANCD2. Hot off the press in 2020, just this year, Tan et al. Shows that Ataxia, Telangiectasia, and RAT3 related protein, ATR, phosphorylates three serine residues on FANCA. And this is actually what enables it to be monoubiquitinated. So the core complex is composed of 8 Fanconi anemia proteins and 3 Fanconi anemia associated proteins. So they're given the abbreviation FAP, standing for Fanconi anemia associated proteins. The core complex proteins are FANC A, B, C, E, F, G, L, M, and then the 3 Fanconi associated proteins are FAP20, FAP24, and FAP100. The core complex proteins actually consist of 3 subcomplexes. So you have BL100, Fanconi anemia proteins. When we're saying the names, we say FANC, as in FANC. So you just hear people say FANC A, FANC B, FANC C. So they're referring to the Fanconi anemia proteins. So it will be BL100, which are FANC B, FANC L, and the FAP100. So that's a subcomplex, and this subcomplex guides the assembly of the whole complex. Then FANCF forms a subcomplex that forms a bridge for the interaction with the target FANCI, FANCD2. And then the target FANCI, FANCD2, which gets monoubiquitinated. And then there is AG20, which are FANCA, FANCG, and FAP20. And this complex guides the localization of the proteins to the nucleus. I should mention at this point that this understanding of the core complex assembly is based on from Van Twist's 2017 molecular cell paper. However, knowledge and insights into the structure is rapidly evolving. Take, for example, a look at this core complex assembly that's been deposited in the protein databank by Shaquille et al. It was published in Nature just last year, 2019, and just highlights the importance of keeping an eye on the literature for more up-to-date and in-depth look. This is just a broad overview of the pathway, so let's continue. The E3 ligase is assisted by a ubiquitin conjugating enzyme, UBE2T, also known as FANCT. So once the core complex ubiquitinates FANCI, FANCD2, after the monoubiquitination of FANCD2 and FANCI, a host of proteins interact in this pathway, beginning with the recruitment of a scaffolding protein. The scaffolding protein is FANCP. It's also known as SLX4. You may come across it as SLX4. That is needed in subsequent steps of the biochemical pathway. The core complex recruits endonucleases, these are proteins that cut DNA, to cut the interstrand crosslinks. The endonucleases are FANCQ. FANCQ is also known as XPF, and it's also known as ERCC4, so watch out for those names. So these three endonucleases cleave the interstrand crosslink and leads to a DNA adduct and a double-strand break in the DNA where the interstrand crosslink was. The DNA adduct is bypassed with the help of DNA exonucleases, Rev1, Rev3, and Rev7. Rev7 is also known as FANCV. So the three endonucleases do this by forming what is known as a translesion synthesis complex. The resulting double-stranded break from the cut by MUS81, FANCQ, and SLX1 is repaired by homologous recombination. Various proteins play a role in this part, so pay attention. Three other exonucleases are called on: CTIP, MRN, and XO1, and they cut the double-stranded break that resulted to create a single-stranded DNA with a 3' overhang. The single-stranded DNA is coated initially by a protein called Replication Protein A, or RPA for short. So then another protein, another Fanconi Anemia protein, FANCR, a recombinase, recognizes the Replication Protein A covered single-stranded DNA. This leads to the removal of RPA and stimulation of a recombination filament. The recombination filament formation is assisted by Rad51C, it's also called FANCO, FANCJ, partner and localizer of BRCA2, also known as FANCN, BRCA2, also known as FANCD1, and XRCC1, also known as FANCU. The recombination filament searches for homologous bases to finally repair the interstrand crosslink. So with that, I thank you for watching. If you found this helpful, please give it a thumbs up, or if you have any comments or questions, you can leave it in the comments below. All the best with your FA-related research.